I've now made the full switch from URP to HDRP. If you remember my Devlog number 2 and 3 videos from a long time ago, those were simply trying out HDRP only with real-time lighting. Now the entire development is based on HDRP, and I go through baked indirect lighting in order to get much better results in terms of graphics compared to my previous scenes. I'm still learning about HDRP, and there's some topics that I haven't delved into yet, and those are things like bent normals, subsurface scattering with diffusion profiles, or custom shaders. But even without them, there's so much you can do with HDRP that's not possible with URP. Things like motion blur, ambient occlusion, volumetric fog, real-time shadow from point lights, and many more. The overall quality and lighting details is incomparable. Last week, out of the blue, I made the simple test scene, and seeing the results, I decided to make the transition to HDRP. I've always wanted to build dark scenes with a lot of subtle light sources, and for a while Unity kept the total number of lights limited for LWRP, which made it so confusing and combined with lower graphical standards unattractive to use. Now I don't have to deal with that. The bigger issue is the steep learning curve in achieving graphical fidelity with so much new technical stuff. The URP, I believe, is still a decent choice for mobile devices, or anything that doesn't have the power of a gaming rig. So I'm not saying HDRP is just better, but it's my choice because I'm building for PC. This video is not going to be a full-on tutorial, so I'm not going to go through every little step, but you can check out my repository and see the project yourself in your own time. If you do want tutorials where I might focus on talking about a single subject in depth, let me know in the comments. For now, let me just share the important key points that I went through and learned in making the transition to HDRP. They're using volume profiles, baked lighting, HDRP lit shaders, mask maps, materialize, VFX graphs, and Blender for creating 3D textures. In this video, I'm going to focus on volume and lighting. The rest I will continue in the following video. If you create an HDRP project in a new scene, immediately you're going to notice the volume profile. HDRP includes this by default, so you don't have to install other packages like post-processing stack. I see some people still using post-processing stack or trying to use two different packages at the same time, but I advise against that. You can click on Add Override to add post-processing effects or other properties that affect how the scene gets rendered. The sky and fog settings profile is something you cannot edit and save, so you should create a new profile and then add whatever overrides that you want. Install ProBuilder and ProGrids. And you can start playing around with simple geometric shapes. And all these different settings. If you check out my repository, you'll see that I'm using a bunch of overrides. One thing that I like in particular is having emissive material and then using bloom to have this scatter effect. Or I can also have a light source and use fog to render this volumetric lighting. If you haven't already, I recommend checking out this channel called UGuruz. He does a good job in explaining his methods of using post-processing and lighting to create a good-looking scene. I don't follow him exactly the same because I think sometimes he overkills it with the numbers in the light mapping settings, but his videos did give me some good ideas on which options I want to use for my own project. I'm sure you'll find his videos just as helpful. Also, check out this video by Unity in achieving high fidelity graphics. If you don't have prior experience with HDRP, I recommend working with simple scenes, simple shapes, ProBuilder, and ProGrid to play around with the settings until you're comfortable, or until you can get the look and feel that you like. Usually when you bake light maps, you're going to get a scene that looks a lot better than a scene that only uses real-time lighting, and I'm going to explain why in a second. I like baked indirect because in terms of performance, it's less expensive than shadow mask, but you can still get similar results or sometimes better. By using this option, you're creating light maps only for the indirect lighting while shadows from direct lighting will be rendered real-time. The difference between direct and indirect lighting is pretty obvious. Here in my room, I'm pointing my light to the wall, and this part of the wall is receiving direct light, but the rest of the room gets lit up gently from the light that's bouncing off the walls. I like indirect lighting because it's subtle. The difference between lighter and darker areas sort of blur, and it's smoother than, say, pointing a flashlight directly at something and getting clean, hard shadows. If you want to mimic how actual light particles behave for maximal graphical fidelity, you would trace the path for every pixel to be rendered from every light source, and each particle can bounce around different surfaces a number of times. At 60 frames per second or more, calculating all those particle paths becomes an impossible task. Real-time ray tracing theoretically gets closer to them than ever before, but we're not talking about that in this video. In order to bake your scene and create light maps, make sure that all your non-moving objects are checked static, or contribute global illumination. Shadows of moving objects such as a player, of course, will not and should not be baked into the light map texture. Also, for all meshes that you want to bake, make sure you check Generate Light Map UVs, unless you're creating your own light maps with other software like Blender. When you click on Bake, Unity spends a long time calculating all the data of the light path and saves it in texture so that you don't have to do it while you're playing the game. Direct sample count refers to the number of paths calculated from each point affected by direct lighting. Indirect sample count refers to the number of paths calculated from each point affected by indirect lighting. Bounce refers to how many times a path can bounce off a surface. Lightmapping filter refers to the blurring of the result of these calculations. You need blur because when you try to trace paths that bounce off everywhere, you might have a certain amount of undesired noise. I might be oversimplifying this, but combine all these calculations and you end up with texture data that represents how every surface is affected by the light particles. You want to be careful with the texels per unit option. You can test this yourself, but starting from 1, every time you increase the number, you're dramatically increasing the total number of units used in tracing the light paths. The more units you have, the longer time it takes to bake. For the final product, I'd look at each of the objects individually and set up different scales. For example, it's inefficient to have this many units for the props in here because you can barely even see them from the outside. Whereas more units would be needed for the car, which is more detailed both in shape and reflections, and it's closer to the camera and is a lot more important in making the scene look good. For other objects that barely receive any kind of indirect lighting, we can cut down on scale. For small or thin objects like this lamp pole, I'm not using light mapping at all. Contribute global illumination is turned off for this object. Later, I might start using light probes for smaller objects or dynamic objects to go deeper into improving both performance and quality, but for now, I'm happy enough with the results. Here's another page that I recommend, Art of Lighting. I know I'm merely pointing to a bunch of other sources, but there's so much info and technical stuff you have to know about lighting that I cannot explain everything in this video, but my repository is public. Anything that's not fully explained in this video, you can download and check out the actual project, run it yourself with the exact same settings that I'm using, play around with it, and see how each of the options work with your own eyes. I also noticed there's a lot of lag in the editor, but the game runs fine once you build it. If you don't have a gaming rig, you can tone down the settings, lower the numbers until your computer can run it smoothly. Here's an example. I think there's also some lag coming from ProBuilder, but again, once you build it, it should be fine. Or later, for gameplay testing, I can turn off everything else but the characters and platforms, so I'm not too concerned. In case you're wondering, I'm using i7-6700K and GTX 1080. It's getting old, but it's still a decent machine. Since I'm building for reasonably high-end PCs, I have more leeway than targeting phones. You can check out my light mapping settings in my repository. I also recommend watching this video from Unity where they go in-depth with each of the numbers and light mapping concepts. It's almost an hour long, but very worth it. If you still want me to talk about concepts like texels, let me know in the comments. More importantly, play around and run experiments until you're familiar with the options. In fact, this scene was built with simple shapes using ProBuilder and ProGrid, and the props are imported from free assets from the Unity Asset Store. I'll have the list of links below. Obviously, you can still bake with URP, but combined with volume and many other properties, HDRP in most cases is going to look better. For textures and materials, let me continue in the next video. I apologize for not putting it all into a single one, but there's just too much info and technicalities that I find it hard to do so. I spend most of my time developing, so please be patient with me. Next video, I'll talk about importing maximal characters, using materialize to create mask maps, and a few more methods that I used in creating this HDRP scene. Thanks for watching. Let me know if you have any questions. You can reach me on my Discord server. I'll see you soon.